You've clicked on this video for one of two reasons. A, the thumbnail features a rolling stock in your country of residence and it's your civic duty to watch this video. Or B, you're a transit fan and probably wondering why I would pick a fight against conventional rail, which I'll explain in around 10 seconds. The LRT or light rail transit was once envisioned as the future of Singapore's transportation. It is an autonomous people mover system used to bridge the last mile gap from the MRT and ease vehicle congestion in towns with congested streets. Each vehicle has rubber tyres and each system is said to be around 10 kilometers long, away from the street level so that transit will not slow down cars. I mean, yeah, that's the actual reason stated. Vice versa, of course, and at that time, automated systems were a big deal. Feasibility studies of this type of transportation were carried all around the island. However, only three lines stand today, namely the Bukit Panjang, Sengkang, and Punggol LRT. Why is that so? The definition of the term LRT varies across different cities. For example, the KJ line in KL is a four-car conventional rail system with express services, and that in Jakarta refers to a conventional rail system with two cars. So for the avoidance of doubt, what I'll refer to in this video as LRT is the type found in Singapore, an automated people mover system. LRTs in general are what transit fans refer to as Gadgetbahns, a portmanteau comprising of two words, Gadget and Bahn, meaning rail in German. Gadgetbahns attempt to revolutionize transit and fix congestion through some kind of technological fix. In the 20th century, the Skybus. In 2020, Elon Musk Thanos. There are a few key points that make a great transit system, and as shown in this blog about Gadgetbahns, they are cost, speed, comfort, safety, capacity, reliability, and accessibility. And to assess these characteristics, we will be taking a look at Singapore's first LRT line, the Bukit Panjang LRT, opened in 1999 at a cost of $285 million. Starting with cost and safety, the LRT has no level crossings, making it safer than a conventional bus. However, while the LRT is cheaper to construct than the MRT, it is much more expensive than conventional light rail and is more expensive to operate than the MRT. Elevating a system costs more than building at grade, and a huge advantage that should come with it is greater comfort, as it doesn't need to conform to surface gradients, and thus achieve higher speeds with better track layout. But in Bukit Panjang, the tracks were instead built to wrap around structures, twisting in all directions, making the ride less comfortable. When then Transport Minister Khaw Boon Wan took a ride on it, he famously remarked, "I won't say I enjoyed the ride. It caused me dizziness also. But that is life." And he even went on to say that the LRT was designed in a masochistic manner. Besides, some stations were built at suboptimal locations, and the line ran really close to buildings, with the average gap being just 8 to 10 meters from residents' homes. So in order to protect their privacy, smart glass panels needed to be installed. These cost around 5 times that of a regular glass panel, and to be honest, they look kind of futuristic. But due to reliability issues, many remain permanently opaque, not allowing passengers to see what's outside when commuting. Being a transit system situated in Bukit Panjang, there's just one thing to conquer, and that's a long hill. Turns out sending people movers designed for flat airport terrain up and down huge gradients with sharp turns isn't a great idea, with the line having the worst reliability in Singapore. Breaking down on its day of opening, having doors open while it's in motion, wheels falling off the cab, and even colliding in the year 2000. MKBF, or mean kilometers before failure, is Singapore's way of measuring system reliability. This for the Bukit Panjang LRT in 2016 was 36,000 kilometers, which, okay, sounds a lot. But that for the nearby downtown line was 260,000 kilometers, meaning that the LRT was 7 times more unreliable. And as such, rovers have to be deployed at stations meant to be unstaffed, defeating the purpose of automation. Oh, and the system has rather bad capacity. If they were made to travel long distances, you need 3 of these connected together just to seat the same number of passengers as a single MRT train car does. And it's not that space efficient too. For comparison, a bendy bus which made its debut in the same year as the LRT carries 149 passengers, and it is more space efficient than an LRT car while having twice the percentage of passengers seated. Now you might be saying, hold on a second, the bendy bus of yesteryear wasn't wheelchair accessible, which is a valid point. And this brings me to the next point of accessibility. Because the stations were built on one side of the road, Say if you lift across it, you'd have to use these apex ladders with handrails. So if your station is wheelchair accessible but you can't get there in the first place, that kinda defeats the point of it. Fortunately, lifts were installed recently, but this doesn't solve a problem with the system, access penalty. This refers to the time you need to get from the station entrance to the vehicle. This for a bus is nothing, as you get on the bus from the bus stop. This for the LRT is around 1 minute. You enter the station, climb up some stairs, then enter the vehicle. And this brings us to our final point, speed. With all the aforementioned twists and turns, excess penalty, low capacity, there's just one final question. Is the LRT faster than the bus? The only way to find out is to try it out for myself. You may watch the full video which I'll link to in the description, but I'll just share the findings I got here. The journey on the LRT car has a higher average speed than that of the bus, but factoring the time needed to enter and exit the system, the LRT is slower than the bus. To put this in perspective, we spent nearly $300 million on an over-elaborate, expensive transit right-of-way that has suboptimally located stations, is uncomfortable, unreliable, slower than a regular bus without transit signal priority, and has the capacity of a bus but with the movement restrictions of a train. At this point, how did the Bukit Panjang LRT even got a green light in the first place? And truth to be told, political pressure. Yep, as you can tell, it's the wrong tool for the wrong job. Fortunately, the two other towns, Sengkang and Punggol, had the LRTs integrated into the town's plan from the very beginning, and as of 2016, is twice as reliable as the one in Bukit Panjang. But even so, Singapore's LRTs have one less fatal flaw. It's that they are not light rail. According to the manufacturer, it's called an automated people mover system, and other cities which use it call them as it is. Light rail looks like this. Steel on steel rail, surface level transportation, and it looks like a train. I personally find this upbranding of Singapore's transit really annoying, as it can bamboozle people into thinking that light rail is crap when it's actually so much better. But beyond all that political pressure, masochistic rides, and upbranding, let us ask ourselves, why do we need over-elaborate elevated LRT structures? Well, so that public transit doesn't slow down cars. Why do we even need the LRT in the first place? To fix traffic. And did it happen? Absolutely not. According to traffic statistics from Maven Technologies, Punggol has been a long-term champion for having the worst congestion levels in the nation. Also, when plans to replace then 17-year-old Bukit Panjang LRT with a bus system surfaced, that plan was quote, not far-fetched, but was slashed because, and I quote, lead to more congestion on the roads. And now, the city is spending another $300 million in attempt to fix it. So what's the solution? If there's one important lesson traffic engineering in the 20th century has taught us, it's that
we're running out of room. We didn't dream big enough.
The only way to fix traffic congestion is by making the alternatives more viable and convenient than driving. It worked in Copenhagen, it worked in Amsterdam, and so will it in Singapore. So let's start off by taking two of these seven lanes and turning them into a transit right-of-way on the ground. Put them in the median so that transit doesn't get affected by turning cars. To improve efficiency, we can sink some rails into the ground and let's call the train cars trams. Suddenly, you don't need these huge amounts of concrete to lift the tracks, lifts, and overhead bridges because the street is now safe to cross. And you don't need these expensive glass panels to stop people from looking inside of your home. When there's enough demand, you expand the station at ground level rather than getting more manpower to drive buses running parallel to the system. If only there's a city which has that in real life. Welp, turns out there is. This is Plantage Middenlaan in Amsterdam. A 10-meter right-of-way with grassy tram tracks and bicycle paths on both sides, and it moves 17,500 people per hour. In comparison, Petir Road in Bukit Panjang, almost twice as wide, has a capacity of just a fifth of that figure, meaning that this street in Amsterdam is approximately 10 times more efficient than the one in Singapore. Building a system like this will in fact decrease congestion because induced demand works for public transit too. In fact, it works for every mode of transportation, and what kind of demand a city would like to induce is entirely by choice. Amsterdam has 5 times the car ownership rate as Singapore and has no congestion charging, yet people simply don't drive that often because cycling or taking public transit is made to be the preferred option by convenience rather than something you take because you can't drive. And turns out because cars are only used when you need one in Amsterdam, sitting in traffic is a rare occurrence, and according to Waze, is the most satisfying country to drive in. Building an LRT or Gadgetbahn in general, and in the case of Bukit Panjang, is just an example of the wrong tool to the wrong solution to the wrong problem. Spending hundreds of millions on an over-elaborate transit right-of-way that is slower than a regular bus is really something, and I wonder, what message does it send to the people? Removing transit from the streets just so a wealthy minority of individuals could drive their cars faster is a terminally car-brain solution to transit. Well, cars are for professionals, of course.
There's no better way for people to know me.
And I mean the car you drive and stuff, you know?
Well, everybody has a car.
How many cars do you have?
I have two, my wife drives one, I drive one. We're both professionals, we need to travel.
So if you can't fork out $1,000 a month for transportation, too bad. You'll be stuck in one of these for your daily commute. A system with high access penalty is highly congested, aircon sometimes working, that you can't look outside of, except for a few posters on overhead bridges you'd pass by. Someone else is driving, I can only daydream. Thank you for watching to the end of this video. Shout out to my patrons who have made this video possible. And special thanks to GlitchFan2428 for that clip of their overhead bridge. If you'd like to support the channel, you may treat me a cup of tea at patreon.com/teh siu tai. Thank you.